bitch to start kicking ass, just like it said at the beginning of the program.
Man of the hour, tower of power, too sweet to sour.
Sending your ass on the jabroni jet to the other side of the territory, brother.
The Alabama Hammer.
Nightmares are the best part of my day.
The goods from the wood.
Hot damn!
Welcome to The Goods from the Woods. My name is Rivers Langley.
I'm Pat Riley, everyone.
And joining us on Mic 3, our very special guest host,
Rick Wood. I didn't have a rhyming thing this time.
No, it's okay. No worries. And our very special guest today, been wanting to have her on the show for a very long time, and I believe I met this person like within months of moving here. I think you and I have been here about the same time. Please introduce yourself.
Hey, I'm Georgea Brooks.
Georgea Brooks. And you moved from Canada to Los Angeles in 2012, right? Or was it before that?
6 years ago. So was that right?
Yeah. I think there was like a shipment of just people in 2012.
Did you move with Neil?
I moved like maybe 2 months after Neil got here. So it's like that whole summer was just waves of people that are still around and still
and
doing fun stuff.
Look at us now.
Yeah. Killing it.
Yeah, because I remember there was like a big influx of people right when the Westward Brew Coast like closed down. Like shortly before Westward Brew Coast closed down, there was just like a wave of people that came in. And yeah, I remember just Robert Yassimore getting so mad where he's like, all these fucking people moving into this. I have to remember everyone's fucking names.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
I remember the first time I did that mic and I was like, this guy, I don't know if I should do it. This guy's like so mean. But then I, not to brag, had a great set on the open mic and he was so nice to me and he's like, you should come back.
Same here.
It was great.
I had the exact same experience where I stood there. I was like, this dude is terrifying. And then he was like, good job. You did well.
That like, always means so way more.
Yeah. I was like, do I have to fight you now that you were complimentary? I don't know. I don't know what this means. But yeah, thank you. Thank you so much for being here. What part of Canada did you move here from originally, by the way?
Well, originally I'm from like a small town near Toronto, but that's where I started comedy in Toronto.
Oh, okay, right on. But yeah, no, it's funny. I lump you in with this category as well of just like people that come from Canada who are just fucking great and they just show up here and are just murdering all the time. And it's a thing where I think it was Jared Logan referred to Canada as the Galapagos Islands of comedy because it's separate. It's like adjacent and yet separate. And there's such a funny style that's slightly different from everywhere else I've ever seen. And so, you know, you get folks coming in from Canada who are just, you know, out the box killing it. So,
wow.
I
don't know if I appreciate you lumping me into that group. I don't know if I deserve it.
Oh, shut up.
I'm not trying to insult myself.
What a Canadian thing to say.
What I'm trying to say is like, here's the thing. Don't get me wrong. I'm very funny now. But when I moved here, like a lot of Canadians get really good and like hit the ceiling in Canada and then move here. But I was like, fuck this place. And I moved like after 2 years of doing state.
Oh,
like
is that
I feel
right?
Like LA actually made me... Like, Canada does not know who I am. Whereas, like, Steph Tolev or somebody, they all know her because she, like, did comedy there a lot longer.
Sure. We've had her on the show, too. I told her the same thing, actually, of just, like, yeah, it's funny. And you actually were here before she was. I actually remember one of the first comedy shows I saw, I believe it was at Lyric Hyperion, and I think on the lineup was you and Tom Sibley were two people that I remember from... I fuck me if I could remember anything else about the show except for
Do
that.
Do we have to fuck you?
Well, no. But
That's so great.
But yeah, and I just remember like, because I came here from Alabama, and it was like one of those things like sitting there watching that show specifically and just being like, oh, this people aren't fucking around here. Like it was one of those things. And I remember you from that. That's my earliest Georgea Brooks memory is that.
The crazy thing about that is like, I love that you're like, everyone was so great. They weren't fucking around. Meanwhile, I was like so nervous for that show because like, either I just started dating Tom or like I wasn't, I don't know.
Oh, I didn't even know you dated Tom,
We
actually.
Were dating.
No, I didn't even know that,
and
actually.
We like, I was just like so nervous.
Oh,
you know
okay.
I mean?
Yeah, I didn't actually know that you guys dated. I didn't mean to bring that up or anything.
I mean, I really was the one who was like, and let's not forget, I dated him.
Okay, good. Okay, yeah. I didn't mean to trigger a sore subject.
You did it not at all.
All right, good.
We're
good,
very
good.
Friendly. I just
okay,
was
good,
saying
good,
like,
good, good.
It's just so funny
Tom's
to hear
a friend.
That.
We all love Tom.
Where you're like, you seem so professional. I was like, I thought I would die on that show. Are you okay?
Well, I mean, it's the it's just Rivers in the backtrack,
accidentally falling into an awkward beehive potentially.
Well, I mean, it's the Lyric Hyperion. I remember my first show at the Lyric Hyperion. I was very nervous myself because it's like one of those places that. Like, it seems more legit than it actually is. Because it's just like, whoa.
They bought curtains.
Yeah, they have a black box theater with curtains and a back area with multiple green rooms. Like, oh my God, this is...
It's a restaurant that looked at most of the restaurants and said, well, we're never going to sell this much coffee and sandwiches. Put a theater in there.
Yeah, why not?
It's also one of those venues that I feel like when it first like opened, it got a lot of like... big names, but then like very slowly over time it's like now just open mics or something, you know what I mean?
Yeah, it really has become.
And they're all
like
hosted by Sam,
they're
all hosted
by trying to do a show there.
They're all hosted by sometimes guest host of the show, Sam Harder. Shout out to Sam out there, who's actually is actually I think hosting a mic right now at the Lyric.
Yeah. I like his promo for his mics,
which is just shitting on people on the LA Facebook message, and it's on the LA Facebook.
Then you talk to him, he's like, no one really likes me. I don't think he's ever actually said it.
I remember, there were being multiple, like, there's a mirror in this, like a vanity.
Yeah, they have two green rooms. With lights.
And I thought it was, and I was doing, like, Maddie Carter Opel's pizza party or something.
Yes! I saw him.
And, like,
He's in Jurassic World. I saw him in Jurassic World.
He's in Stranger Things.
That's what I mean about big people like doing the shows there. That show was dope.
Yeah, no, I think it was on there with like Eric Andre and like a bunch of other people, like Melissa Villasenor, like basically all these people that like at the time were just, you know, kind of
people who were around.
Around, you know, and it was just like, oh yeah, I have to, and there's actual people in here, and this is like a theater, and it just
blew my mind. It is a nice space.
Yeah, it blew my mind, because I was used to doing like pizza pubs and stuff, you know?
I once filmed a TV show at that venue. Like,
yeah,
they
I was
were
on
like...
a pilot there, too. I was like, wow, this is nice.
Wait, which one?
They sell bagels here?
I said TV, but it was like internet TV.
Hey, that still counts.
It was called... I don't remember what it was called.
Right on.
But it was for like Lifetime with Hello Giggles.
Sure.
And we just had to like talk about embarrassing like stories.
Yeah.
Like all girls, all little girls, women, grown women.
Yeah, if you need to film a panel thing. Yeah. Right? That's like a good, like, our version of The View.
Yeah. Well,
Lyric Hyperion.
Where did you, because you just did the record, where did you tape the record?
I recorded my album at Chatterbox.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Dope. Perfect.
It was so good.
Super dope venue. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm very thrilled to basically, like, I was like, I need to do something.
Yeah.
Because I'm not doing anything.
I need to prove I exist.
Truly. I'm like, I'm getting very sick of these jokes. And then also, like, my Canadian friends make so much money from their album because, like, they play it in Canada a lot.
Yes.
They have to play Canadian artists.
Canadian content. Yeah.
Now, as I already said,
Canada,
like,
first, baby.
Canada first. It's a slogan. So they were like, we make money that way. So I was like, I have to record it somewhere. But it's so, like, I was like, who's going to give me stage time in LA? I don't want to travel. Like, I don't have weekends anywhere, really. So,
Steve Hernandez. Mm-hmm. Shout out to Big Hearn.
The best show in LA. In Covina.
It really is.
Yeah. It's so funny because I know people that are from West Covina, and I'm like, oh man, you ever been to the Chatterbox? And they're like, oh man, that place is a dive, man. Why would you want to be there?
That's amazing.
Every bar I love, that's people go, ooh, please. I'm like, you want to see a dive? That's not a dive. They've got a new wall.
Yeah, they got a new wall, finally.
They finally put the door on the men's restroom stall.
Yeah, it's not just a swinging door.
You can poop there now. Yeah. That should be their new, like, Chatterbox. You can poop here now.
One time I went to Chatterbox, and it was like there were actual real patrons there that like go there. And I remember I was there. You were there. I was there as Butt Rock Brett. And there were actual people just talking to me like I was a dude.
Oh, yeah.
Like
yeah.
I was an actual
like
human
character?
Being. Yeah.
But then he fit in there just like, you know.
So they didn't bat an eye, huh?
Yeah, exactly. He fit in there just so perfectly. Square peg in a square hole.
Oh, yeah. Some guy in a Limp Bizkit shirt and baggy-ass like cargo like camo nose. Shorts.
Like, this guy's great. They had this guy here once, Pat Riley. He sucked. We love this Brett.
They like... they're my favorite kind of audience. So like, I just love those people. It's like, yeah, I like young people who work, who have like jobs.
Yeah.
You know I mean, that
yeah.
aren't in Hollywood, but like are fun and they like to drink. I like an audience that'll talk to me too.
Yeah. Hell yeah. Well, we've just, you know, in real time, just come back from Christmas break and I was down in Alabama for 10 days doing shows in Nashville, doing shows in Alabama.
Oh, well, Mr. Hollywood over here.
Well, no. But my point is, there's a thing that always happens when you come off of doing shows for normal people like mm-hmm. Covina, and then you come back into LA, you hit this brick wall of reality where you're like,
no,
oh God,
this brick wall of not reality.
Yeah, I suppose. of my reality that I've opted in for.
Yeah.
Of just, you're like, have all these, this shit that just worked really, you know, was doing gangbusters on the road, and then you just get back and you're just like, oh God. And so
you have to leave LA to like love comedy again.
Yeah.
I remember I thought I was like, I'm gonna quit, I hate this. And then I went to like a road date in Lake Tahoe and I was like, no, I love comedy.
Yeah, it's fun again.
People who need it have, like the improv, I don't, it's always people there, I'm like, you've had enough fun. Like the people
right.
who go to the Hollywood Improv, they're
right,
like, this is like the worst part of their night. They're like, this is the worst chair I'm going to sit in this week. I'm not the focal point of the evening.
That's,
and I'm
so
just
funny.
Like, yeah, I know. Your dog makes more money than me.
And those are people who like work in the industry. So all day they've been working some form of entertainment. Even if it's, they're not like managers or something, they're like, I'm a sound editor. And they're like, we don't want to watch more talent at night. Like,
yeah.
So sick of it.
I did a show that I organized in Waverly, Alabama, which is the town where we have the Waverly Boogie every year. It's a big music festival. And next to the stage where they have this music festival, there's a little cabin. I think it's 120 years old, and it is like the perfect size for a comedy show. It holds like 60 people or so, and it's small, and they've turned it into a music venue. So it's like, you know, got amenities and everything like that. And I've been trying to get the owner to let me do a comedy show in there forever. And we finally got one together, and it was fucking awesome. Like it was you know, packed out. We had a great crowd, and I had comedians from you know, our friend Monica Scott came up from New Orleans. She brought Alex Lucan, another comedian from New Orleans. We had Ben Sawyer, past guest on this show, from Nashville, and Joe Raines, of course, our erstwhile guest host here as well. And so we had this really fun show, and except that you know, it was a lot of people who had driven up from Auburn, where I'm from. You know, it's about 10 miles away. But then also the Waverly locals were there. And this is a town that normally has 100 people in it. And the drunkest man in Alabama was there.
This guy's got to be pretty high running for the drunkest man in the States.
And that's a big hurdle. And so he comes to the show. I hosted, so I went up first. Didn't hear anything out of him during my set. And then Alex Lucan, comic from New Orleans, goes up, and he piped up a little bit during his set, and Lucan shut him down in a very funny way by being like, Dad, I told you not to come to the show drunk, you know, and everybody kind of laughed. He shut up. Joe Raines goes up, and that's when he starts going fucking nuts. You know, if the punchline was like, you know, my cat or something, he would be like, I have a cat. Mine's funny because, you know, he thought it was a discussion and not a performance. Like,
they used to have town hall in this cabin. I'm here to air a grievance.
Mr. Mayor, you should be ashamed. You ought not talk like that. You're the mayor.
You're the worst alderman since the last alderman.
But he starts talking, and we're all standing on the porch. So it's me, a very funny Atlanta comedian named Dave Perdue, and another Atlanta comic named Mandel. We're all standing on the porch. So it's all comedians out there, and this guy is like,
just wants a story to involve and a very shitty comedian from Tennessee.
A really shitty comedian named Pat Riley.
But we're standing on the porch, and there I hear like a commotion going inside, and I was about to like go up back up to host and like try to delegate or like get him thrown out and shit.
Yeah,
somebody's yelling at him. It turns out one of my English professors brought her husband with her. Before Joe could even say anything to him, goes, sir, you have to shut the fuck up and leave. We all hate you. We want you gone. Get the fuck out of here, sir. And he's screaming at him. And he's like inching towards him the way you would shoo a rabid dog.
It might be this guy's first stand.
If I wasn't wearing my good duck head khakis, I would stomp a mud hole in you right now.
Oh my God, I wish you'd seen his face.
Again,
one of those guys.
Man, we need a video element in this podcast.
I am flummoxed.
Yeah, he was flummoxed. And the guy, he walks outside and shuts the door behind him into a bunch. Like, and so now it's just all the comics on the porch.
All the best comics in the world.
Yeah.
Good ass Atlanta comics and me. And he just walks into
legendary comic Ben Sawyer. And
Yeah. He walks into us and he just goes like, he's like, man, I thought they were supposed to be comedians. And we're all like, yeah, that's all of us, sir. And, you know, Purdue just starts being like, look, man, like, we don't need your help. You know, you can just enjoy the show. And the guy goes, man, I get kicked out of everything.
Yes!
That dude rules.
That's so like, funny.
I was like, oh, so this is obviously an everything problem and not you. Like,
yeah. Well, no comedy show's funny enough for him.
Well, and the thing about this town, there's the venue, there's the bar across the street, and that's it.
So he just wandered across the street.
He got kicked out of both things. That's everything in town.
If you could do that in a night.
If you get kicked out of the post office, that's tic-tac-toe, motherfucker. You're done. Like, that's it. And so he starts, like, complaining, and he had the funniest complaint where he just goes, he's like, yeah, you know, I always wanted to be a rock star. We're all like, uh-huh.
I want to do a show of just those guys.
So
that's what I like. I just have
a
dream
a bunch
of
drunks
just,
up.
Yeah, of just like you get like a venue and you run a comedy show for like
pitch to the Lyric Hyperion.
Yeah, for like 3 months, like run a show like a bar show for 3 months, and then on every 3 months you have the All Stars, and then you just have all the hecklers from those, like, you just get there before you kick them out, get their contact information, be like, yo, you said you want to be a rock star, eh? How about 5 minutes? And just have him do 5 minutes of comedy, and I bet it would either be the most awkward thing ever, be like, yeah, I got a story to tell you, man. There's one guy on the work site. Oh, shit, man. You know, one of those things.
His name was Jesus.
Or he would just,
the damnedest thing.
Murder. It would be either that kind of bimodal thing, where either it would just be like, shit, man.
But then we get to heckle them.
Right. Yeah, sure.
No, but no, everybody's just like watches them and judges them as peers.
Got it.
Yeah, and it'll either be some, you'll have, nine of them probably would suck. One of them would probably just be like, yeah, I need to quit comedy because this guy or woman.
Yeah, it's like, you just started comedy tonight and you're quitting?
Well, this guy, he goes, yeah, I always wanted to be a rock star. I'm like, uh-huh. And he goes, he's like, yeah, I even built a stage out on my land. I got a stripper pole and everything. I was like,
you should have done the show there.
Well, I was, that's what.
Sorry, do I keep.
Things are in the works. Because then the next thing he said was the most amazing part. He goes, I got a stripper pole and everything. And then he goes, but I'm the only one that ever uses it.
Yeah.
And I was like, I would pay $1,000 to see you on a stripper. A 65-year-old fucking bean pole trying to get on a stripper pole would be incredible.
That's the ultimate drunk move, too, by the way. Like, building the kind of place you'd want to get drunk at on your own property. And then you're like, man, if everyone could just make the bar at my house, I could really cut down on these DUIs. And eventually he's like, what if the bar was a strip bar?
Man, my son, my college ass son, he thought he'd be cute and to give me one of those strip aerobics DVDs because my strip pole, but shit, I think I might give it a try. You know,
I didn't realize it's the pole that spins, not you have to spin around the pole.
Yeah, it's my safe space, man. I'll just put on Cowboy by Kid Rock and I just do my routine.
This life goes to 11.
Yeah, if they get one of those alternative burlesque shows out here, shoot, man, I'll sign up.
I knew a guy
all
that
them
looked...
who can get them bills.
The listeners could see your face when you do Benji. It's like you transform your whole body.
A lot of consternation.
Are you an actor?
No. Oh, okay. Not at all.
Weird. Oh, my little country cottage in the woods down by the river. Winding down the lane, lined with little purple flowers. I stop to gather berries for my rustic summer kitchen. I eat my little sandwich and it tastes like crap. Oh, I've got my little garden and my peas just started sprouting. My kitty's bounding happily in the sun, she's very happy. And I've got my little shovel for weeding and for digging. Gonna learn to play the flute and kill myself.
I knew a dude named Captain Leo.
Captain Leo?
He'd hang out at this bar called Waterfront Mary's in Wisconsin. It was like, had a hotel that was the hotel bar, I guess. It's like, this is like middle of nowhere, Wisconsin. It's not like a hotel bar like you'd imagine if someone says hotel bar. It's
a bar that happens to have a hotel.
On a shipping canal in Sturgeon Bay with a hotel. And everyone called him Captain Leo. And I didn't know if he had a fucking boat. No, he did. He did have a boat that was out of the water.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's either on the land or underneath the water.
Yeah, it was like a boat on blocks.
Yeah, it's like Cougar Town.
And he'd sit on the deck of this yellow sailboat on blocks that I don't know if it ever seen water. And he had like a... He built his own karaoke machine, like out of shit you'd find at like a pier. So it had like instead of regular speakers, it had like those like cartoon loud horn things.
Oh yeah, I was hoping it would have the foghorn from a big cruise ship.
It's really upsetting that both these guys could build better shit than I could ever do. And I'm sober a lot of the time.
Drunks in the country got skills. You can't live. Handy. Particularly in a cold ass place like Wisconsin, you physically can't stay alive there as a drunk person without some skills.
Yeah, apparently, story was like an inventor or something. Or he did something that got him a lot of money, and then he was like, "You know what I'm gonna do with all this money? Be drunk as hell."
I love that.
And those guys, and a lot of those guys, like they go to Votech in high school and they get like a job at a factory. And a lot of the downtime, they just get like the materials from work, and they're just like, "Hey, man, I got a union job. Nope, they got to pay me, so I'm just going to build some stuff. You know, I'll build you a barbecue grill. I'll build myself a massive karaoke sound system.
So fucking
strip
cool.
pole.
This
he always wanted to bring it around. I play
salvage.
I've been playing bands with dudes at this bar, and he'd show up with the karaoke thing. You guys need more sound equipment? Like, no, Leah. One night he came into the bar.
A Bravo foghorn.
He comes in the bar one night in rollerblades, but he wasn't rollerblading. He was wearing them like fucking boots.
He was just
drunker than I've ever seen anyone. He's walking around this bar, like stumbling and like a person on, like he looked like a cartoon of a guy who just stepped on a floor full of marbles.
He
kept falling down and he'd be like, "What is going on?" And he'd be like, "You're on, you got fucking roller skates on, dude."
Oh my God, I love it.
And he looked at his feet and went, and we're like, when did you put on rollerblades?
Did you work there?
I was like, would just hang out. Like,
got it.
I was in a band. Well, I was in a band that played. They had music.
You were just 20 years
in the band
until it was
there.
Him. Yeah,
that's amazing.
Yeah.
I worked at a place like that. Like, I used to go there as a little girl with my dad, and I called the bartender Uncle Bob.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, I was like 4, and hell then when I grew up, I started working there.
And then I was Uncle Bob.
And then I was Aunt Bob.
What was the place?
It was called the Mohawk Inn, and it was beside the Mohawk Racetrack because my hometown had nothing but a horse racetrack.
Nice. Uh-huh.
So everyone that came into the Mohawk Inn, like, they were all regulars, and some of them were rich as fuck, but some of them were poor as hell because you just didn't know, like, who owns a horse and who just brushes a horse.
Right. Oh, yeah.
But then after the races, everyone would come and get, like, so drunk at the Mohawk Inn, and I'd be, like, the only server, like, running around, like, and it was a hotel, so you could just, like, crash.
Yeah, that's where the drunkest happens.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
Oh, I can get a room for $25 at the end of the night.
It was
like,
insane.
It's 2 a.m. You have an empty room.
Cheaper
Do
than a ticket.
Want some money.
I had a crazy thing happen to me at the Mohawk Inn, and this doesn't go with any of your stories.
No, it's perfect.
But so when I worked at the Mohawk Inn, I was like just starting comedy, and I was in this comedy competition where you could win $5,000. And
whoa.
At the time, I was living.
That's a huge payday in comedy still.
Yeah.
I know. It's insane.
In Southern California, it's just Uncle Clyde's and you win nachos.
You know, people have quit their jobs for less out here. I just got $3,000. I made it. Like, you made the quarter, I guess.
I slipped and fell on a Tootsie Roll in CVS. My life has changed.
You have to remember, this is $5,000. Canadian, but still.
Still, I pretty much do horrible things for 5,000 Canadian.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I was doing horrible
like
things
comedy.
Like comedy.
Yeah, like comedy. Yeah.
So but at the time, I was also living in my car. Like, I was home. Like, I just couldn't find an apartment. So I worked at this place called the Mohawk Inn on the weekends in my hometown, and there were these regulars, these, like, 4 guys, and they were regulars, older dudes. Like, I was so nice to them. They loved me. And I told them about the competition. And then next week I came back and I was like, I lost. And so the one guy comes up to me like at the bar after I left his table. And he goes, would $10,000 help your comedy career? And I went, what? Like, of course. Like,
yeah, what do you mean?
And I'm like, I don't know what you're talking about. He's
sounds
like
the beginning to a movie.
Yeah. A horror movie.
He goes, well, $10,000 is nothing to me, so like, I'd love to give you $10,000. And then I was like, I don't know. Let me think about it. That sounds like it's too generous. And the next week, he came in and just had cut me a check for $10,000. And that was the end of that.
Whoa. Holy shit.
I know. Damn. It turned out, I didn't even know. Turned out he like owned a horse. Like he was a horse owner. Like I didn't know. I thought maybe.
Oh, you okay.
I'm drinking at a horse bar.
I was going to say, fuck yeah, fucking Chatterbox.
Know, let's,
go to
help
the, let's go to Santa Ana and start doing comedy over there.
Oh my God, I'd
just
love to go.
Going, I need money.
Well, so crazy, right?
Wow. Wait, hold on. Awesome. Stop. Like, yeah. What did you do with it? Like,
well, the crazy. Okay,
I mean, you're living
actually,
in the car, so did you get an apartment?
She bought a nicer car to live in.
Yeah, it was a van. Ooh, it's like a mansion.
I could squat in this thing.
The crazy thing is, the kid that won that competition, he's like, I'm going to use this $5,000 to go to the States and like pursue comedy. And then he never did. And I used the $10,000 to immigrate to the States.
Fuck yeah. Okay. Yeah. So you did. Yeah.
I like saved it for a long time because here's the thing. I was living in my car. But like, if I really look back on it, I'm like, I was mostly doing it for attention because my parents did not live far away from where I was staying in the car.
It was sort of like the adult version of like, I'm running away from home, and you get a blankie and like a candy.
So stupid.
Bag of candy.
I would always pack my Nintendo games, but never bring my Nintendo.
You're like, I could trade these on the market.
Just like sitting in a bush outside, and then it starts raining, and you just go back in.
Oh my God. Like when I was sleeping in my car, it's because I had an apartment, and then I lost that apartment. But I still had like a parking permit for the neighborhood in Toronto.
Oh, okay.
And this is too much information. But at the time, I just started like kind of like sleeping with this guy who happened to live on that street.
Uh-huh.
So then when I lost my apartment and I moved into my car, he was a comic too. So like we would only like kind of like fool around during the day or like really late at night. So we'd fool around and then I'd leave and I'd go sleep in my car that was like in front of his house.
Wow.
And he's still one of my best friends.
Wow. You didn't just move. You should have just moved in.
He never invited me.
You should have just done it anyway.
I remember he let me sleep over a couple of nights.
Really held up the credence of the friends with benefits.
That's great. Yeah, I was going
to
say.
Went to a car.
I mean, I think he just like stressed out because we just started seeing each other. And I'm like, I'm living in front of your house. Like, so creepy. Man, 21.
I'll probably cut this because I told the story already. But there was a fucking weird, crazy open mic comic who had
was in his car.
Beardhead. No, there's like 10 of those. But yeah. this was Beardhead. I told the story about the guy who had a beard and hair the same length, and he'd shaved it all this with the same clipper. And
yeah, so
he
on
just,
stage.
No, just,
like that,
he just looked psychotic.
Be careful.
And he had this joke where he's like, "I live." I think
you should cut your own hair.
His jokes were they weren't really delivered as premises so much as threats. And so he was just being like, you know what the best part about living in your fucking car is? You know what the best part is? He's like, if a bitch gives you her fucking address, you just park in front of her house and like, I live here now.
Oh, shit.
So
he literally did what I did. You're like, this guy's crazy. And this is what he said. And I'm like, oh, no.
But he was scary. And you got your head screwed on straight.
Yeah, you went back into your car.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I used to like sleep in the back seat and put towels in the rolly up windows and like just roll them down a little bit, sneak a towel in there and roll it back up. Yeah.
But you had like crank windows?
No, it was like electric.
That'd be great if you had like the something about living in a car with. For those of you listening to the podcast instead of somehow watching this, I'm making the roll down a window.
I did that for, sorry.
Oh, yeah.
I did that for like 2.5 months, which I mean, I know people are homeless for way longer, but like, I don't like it's so crazy. It's so stupid.
The question is, what months were they?
It was September to November.
That
so when it started to get
Toronto,
cold, I had to bounce.
I was gonna say, in Canada, that's that could be those 2 months could be deadly.
That's like right now in LA.
Yeah,
now we're all miserably cold. I think it's a terrible 57 degrees.
One job I had, I feel like I'm really coming off like a slut, but you know what? Just being the real me. So I really wanted a dog because here's the other thing.
I love wherever this is going.
So far, you had sex with one guy and then slept in your car, and then someone gave you $10,000 and you didn't even have sex with him.
No.
I think slut's a bit overrated for what you're going off.
Yeah, you're right.
Sounds like a reasonable 20-something.
Yep.
So I just wanted to mention, when I was living in my car, it wasn't because I didn't have money. I just couldn't find an apartment because my parents were paying for everything.
So that's how I would end up living in a car. I think more so just like, I just the application. Don't want
to. Yeah. It's a good thing to fill out. I just, God, can't. No, I relate to that. I'm in the same camp. Yeah. Just having to fill out paperwork, I would rather just sleep in the car.
I pay bills late all the time, not because I can't afford the bills. I'm just like, just come get some money from. Can I Venmo the hospital?
Oh my God!
Can you just send the cops? I'll just give the cops money.
I'm like, just get it out of my account.
Yeah,
man.
It's the whole goot, like looking it up. Yeah. So this job, I didn't need money because I need money for like Chinese food or whatever. Because my parents were like paying for stuff while I was in college. But I really wanted a dog and couldn't afford it. And a friend of mine at the time was working at a strip club. And she was like, I make so much money. I'm a bartender. So I was like, okay, well, maybe I'll come. She's like, we really need a shooter girl, not a stripper, a shooter girl. So I was like, maybe I'll try it.
What is the shooter girl?
So a shooter girl is someone who like walks around with shots.
Oh, yeah.
These were like shooters in like, you know when
like
you
the, like the test like tube test
yeah,
thing?
Yeah, yes.
You buy the gas station? Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Oh, yeah, yeah.
Wait, what?
Oh, I'm a piece of shit.
The place where you take a car?
I don't know about the gas station
They
part of
sell
that.
Them things. In Alabama, you can buy the little test that tubes with like blue and pink. Like they're
with the roses in it?
No, that's the smoking crack.
Yeah.
Which, by the way, funniest joke ever when Nancy Reagan died was like a rose for Nancy and everybody had the crack pipe roses on their Twitter.
Oh, my. Yeah.
Beautiful joke. But no, in Alabama, they have those little, I forgot what the hell they call them down there, but there's like a name. I think they maybe do call them shooters.
I think it is a test tube, right?
But it looks like a test tube, and it's, you know, it's like they are pink and blue and red and green, and they taste like pink and red and green. Like,
yeah, they're real gross. And like, so when I went, it was like a Tuesday, and I just went to see my friend, and she was like, you know what? They need a shooter girl right now. So the guy was like, you can work tonight. We'll see how you do. If you make a lot of money, you can come back. There was like two tables of six people in this whole strip club. Like, not two tables of six. Two tables total of about six, maybe nine people in the whole strip club. And it's like a strip club, like big.
Yeah.
So I like ended up selling so many shooters to these nine people because they just bought me so many shooters. And I got so drunk. And then at the end of the night, I went into the place and I gave the guys money. Job. And I had my money. And he's like, you were great. You can come back. Like, we'd love to have
you. Like, I want to come back.
I went, I can't
and
do
I have
this
three
ever
reasons
again.
Why.
And you just pop puke on his
skull. You overdose on Hypnotic. I was at CVS and I saw a Hypnotic gift set. And I was like, oh my God. First of all, I was blown away that they still made Hypnotic.
Pat, my birthday is on July 14th.
I didn't know Hypnotic was still a thing. And then also, I'm just imagining going to your office, like Christmas party, being like, hey, here's a gift that I gave you, and it's just like a Hypnotic gift set.
Oh, man.
Like
you
just came out of a time machine.
So
I just love the idea of sitting at a table with a bunch of friends and just being like, oh, that one over there, I want her to fall down. I got $14. Let's do this.
It was crazy. They were like missing teeth and shit. Hell like yeah. It was so crazy. I was so wasted, and then it was too late for like the subway, and I had to take this crazy bus home. It was a nightmare. I got home at like 4 in the morning, maybe 5. It was so... People were, like, going to work. It was bad.
Oh, that's... Oh,
never got that dog. I feel like now I'm talking with an accent.
Did you get a dog with the shooter money?
The shooter money sounds
the
like...
The dog's name was Shooter, actually.
Yeah. That'd be great.
Yeah, God. That'd be great. Yeah. Did you get a dog
plus, like, 12% of dogs down south are named Shooter.
Yeah, that's true.
But there is
I bet it's higher.
Because that used to
and
be a
14%
thing.
14% of dudes.
I was going to make that joke.
there used to be a thing in bars that where I grew up where there would be, like, there was nothing funnier than just seeing some guy that was just like mad dogging the entire night, probably wearing like an Affliction t-shirt, just trying to be as tough at MMA as he possibly can, just at that
just
level of drunk where he just like all the artifice goes and they buy the test tubes and they just go completely insane on the test tubes.
They go black.
Like, oh man, these taste good. I want another one. And they just like continuously do these
like
shooters.
Candy.
Yeah, it's like candy.
What drinks do you make with Hypnotic again? Like, what is one?
My girlfriend's going to yell at me at 1:30. 4:30 a.m. That's a good drink to make a hypnotic. I'm going to get in a fight about nothing that lasts a car ride home. That's another drink I made with hypnotic.
I've never seen anybody actually make a mixed drink with hypnotic.
I think you just drink it.
No, it's like a Blue Lagoon or something, like some kind of martini.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sure there's, yeah.
Like those gross martinis where you're just like, I'm going to be sick for a week.
Yeah, that was like where it's pucker. Just like blue Curacao and like some weird shops or something like that. Yeah, yeah. But yeah, there was a bar in my town that was like the go-to where they had a bar in the dog track because that's the big thing in Florida.
I was like, I live by a horse track. I didn't think anything could be less classy.
Yeah, dog track. Dog track. It's like that is morally reprehensible. Even more morally reprehensible.
I want to bet on something I could afford if I could stop betting on things.
And it's, yeah, it was a combination dog track, High Life Fronton.
What's
and
that?
It's so High Life is that sport that you probably saw where it's got the guys have the big baskets on their hands.
I've kind of 100% like, never heard or seen this.
Okay, so there was a sport in Florida called that was kind of like based in, I think it's from Cuba originally.
Yeah, some South or Central.
Yeah, and it's like handball where you hit the ball against the wall.
Yes.
But they have these baskets that look like
a mix of that and lacrosse.
Yeah, it's like the baskets kind of look like a
Fritos.
Yeah,
kind of looks like a big ass wooden Frito you put on your hand.
The highlight balls go like 180 miles an hour.
Yeah,
it's insane. And like guys get hit in the face all the time, and it's scary.
And they die.
But
their head explodes like
that
scanners.
Was a big thing in Florida where people would bet on this on highlight, and it was completely mobbed up, completely fixed.
Yeah,
but like that was the thing. It was that and dog tracks together. It was just like basically the intro of Miami Vice in one building, So they cut down, they closed the High Life Fronton, turned it into a poker room, and then there was a bar in there, and then they closed the poker room, and then they had the dog track, and then they put a comedy club in there. Whoa. And it was just this revolving
thing. It just keeps getting worse.
It more morally further down in the layers of hell. And then, but the bar was still there, and oh my God, there were guys, and just like, everybody's in there wearing a free promotional
They're
t-shirt.
Betting on the comics.
This one's going to die. His nose is going to collapse due to cocaine.
And it's just like one of those comedy clubs where it's just like Jimmy J.J. Walker shows up like every 3 weeks. But
I heard he used to charge per dynamite. That is a real like comedy legend.
Really?
But there's like
hang on, what?
Like Jimmy J.J. Walker's his stand up contracts and stuff. He'd be like, "All right, I'm gonna come do my comedy. If you want me to say dynamite, it's like $100."
Oh, he's the guy that goes dynamite.
Good time.
That's amazing.
I did not know who you were talking about for so long.
Yeah, but
That's just good. That means your brain probably has useful information in it.
But it was like, and then the last legs of it, they still had the comedy club in there, but they put in an internet cafe, which is code for video slots. Because in Florida, there was this thing where if you had an internet cafe, which basically means you had a computer that connected to the internet and a Xerox machine, there was like some end around the laws where you could just put in video slots, was just like the saddest thing ever. Just people just sitting
just
there.
One kid doing a research paper while
where it's just like 80-year-old people blowing their like pensions on caveman Keno.
Damn.
And and it was great because it was all you could eat convenience store basically. You just go in there and it was just like bags of chips and Slim Jims and sodas.
You just pay a flat price?
Did they have
you just like put like some money in the machine.
So it was like at the Venetian when they bring you a gin and tonic, except this is just they just roll over the chili machine and you press the button to chili your hot dog.
Yeah.
I love an all you can eat. It doesn't matter what it is.
Hook it up to my feed tube.
In fact, the Mohawk Inn has a great all-you-can-eat buffet.
Ooh.
You guys keep going.
No. What's on the all-you-can-eat at the Mohawk?
Poutine.
Well,
crab
the thing
legs.
Is, the Mohawk Inn ended up eventually being owned by some people from Hong Kong. So then the buffet became like prime rib and then Chinese food and then hash browns and like... like sausages and
we have
a different
every
Chinese.
That's the best buffet where it's just like the complete like melange of everything.
Oh
yeah.
Boy.
Essentially, where it's just like it's part Golden Corral, part Super China Buffet, part it's just everything in one place.
Oh,
it's just amazing.
And my dad and I used to go every Sunday for my whole childhood
to the Mohawk.
Yeah. With Uncle Bob,
I gotta go
and
to the damn
Aunt Ken. No, Aunt Ken. Ken, Aunt May, and Uncle Ken. Anyways,
I gotta go to the damn Mohawk. It sounds
sold it, and now it's called something else, and everyone hates it.
Oh, boo!
I know.
Damn.
I made so much money when I worked there. Well, 10,000, but yeah. then also yeah. more.
was the $10,000, was that like the craziest like customer you had there, or was there
he was like pretty down to earth, but yeah,
or like the
he owned a horse
story,
you
I
know
guess?
What's so crazy about that is the next week or 3 weeks later or something, he's like, hey, my wife's putting on a charity comedy show, give me your like stand up and let me give it to her, maybe you can do it. And then he never hired me, but like he did give me $10,000. He's like, oh, you know, not enough.
I you know, I'll
it'd be weird to negotiate the fee on that after the yeah. free $10,000.
The only other time I made money on comedy, it was $10,000. So.
I mean, that's pretty good. That covers at least 20 years of LA right there.
Right. I haven't talked to him in so long, but when my album came out, I just sent him like a Christmas card with the album in it.
Oh, nice. Cool.
And on the inside, I thanked him. Like, so hopefully he remembers me and likes that.
Hell yeah.
Oh, that's awesome.
But the one thing about the video slots
yeah.
I completely forgot about is that the video slots, they banned them in the state of Florida.
Uh-huh.
And when they wrote the law, they wanted to make it as vague as possible so there would be no end around.
Yeah.
And they basically banned the internet in the state of Florida.
so they don't even know how fucked up they are.
So they had to take all the video slots out. So, and they also banned greyhound
horses.
Racing.
The horses.
Yeah, horses, yeah.
Ye shall not ride a horse Seminole County.
They banned greyhound racing. So essentially there's this abandoned greyhound track that doesn't have a poker room anymore, doesn't have the video slots. All it has is this shitty comedy club in it.
Oh my god.
So it's just abandoned like mini stadium.
It's Sal's.
That's the most Florida thing I've ever yeah, fucking exactly. heard.
It's totally haunted.
It's yeah. Sal's comedy universe. Just
yeah, yeah.
You have to run a lap and then do your set. Most comics die halfway through.
Billing Vault 2. Here's your omen. When I was just home recently, this is just tell you what times we're living in. An entire wing of the mall has just become a buffet.
Yes, this is the shit I like.
A wing of the mall. What used to be a goddamn JCPenney is now a fucking buffet.
And meet me by the egg roll concourse.
What's it?
It's crazy.
What's it
huge.
Called? Is it like a restaurant?
Yes,
name?
It's a restaurant. It's called Old Times. OLE. Times, old times,
that's
old
crazy.
Times. Oh my god!
Old times buffet. It's fucking massive, and like
you know that's the thing. When there's that much food and that much variety, you're like, you guys aren't nailing any of this.
Yeah, yeah. Or paying attention to how long any of it's been.
It's got to have yes. been there all fucking day. Like you just can't make that much food fresh.
Well, the thing is, like this mall has been dead for years, like every mall. And now suddenly, every retiree in Auburn is just at this buffet.
Yeah.
All day.
I love that.
Hiding Tupperware and shit.
Hanging
in their bags.
Out. Yeah. And I went with my buddy JB, and I was the first time I'd been, and I tried to get like a little bit of everything, sort of a gimmick.
Yeah.
It was the largest plate of food I've ever consumed. Like, just it went on and on. The fucking, like, the salad buffet is the size of your regular
right.
buffet. It was fucking stupid.
We have all the kinds of lettuce.
Yeah, they did. Yeah. And they had no, and then because it's Alabama,
no one wanted
nothing,
any of it.
Nothing like vinaigrette. Nothing yeah. like oil and vinegar. It was just
ranch.
Thousand Island ranch and honey mustard. Those are the only kinds of dressing that exist.
Clarified oh
my
butter.
My dad used
to... Clarified butter.
That's my favorite dressing.
My dad goes to this buffet every day at lunch where he goes to the salad bar, but then he, on top of his salad dressing, he puts gravy.
Fuck yeah. That's
good.
Oh, Canada. That nice. Is.
It's called the fifth wheel truck stop.
Yes, that's awesome.
I've always yeah. been saying there should be more stuff you could put gravy on.
Oh, no, there is if you use your imagination.
Dude, yeah, if
you can put it on anything.
That's Canada shit. That's why I love Canada so much as a country. They're like, we have taken the challenge of what can you not put gravy on, and we say nothing.
Because Canada's like, we're really cold, so we got to put some hot stew on everything.
Yeah, yeah. Who's eating a cold salad when it's 2 below? Fuck that.
My dad.
Every time I go there, I'm like, I'm only eating poutine once. And like half a day later, it's like, all right, maybe 6 times.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
It's so fucking good.
Yeah.
It's like insanity.
They even have it at McDonald's up there. Ugh. And it's decent.
Like well, yeah, because
they already do the fries, right?
Because it legally has to be.
Yeah,
there.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the crazy thing about Canada. Standards.
Standards, yeah, for food. Yeah, so all of, even the fast food is good there.
Oh, my God, the chocolate bars there, it's actual... I didn't know you guys don't... Like, you guys call them candy bars because...
Yeah, it's barely chocolate.
Barely chocolate, but in Canada, it's like, you're like, this is milky.
Yeah. Yep. That was the first thing I ate the first time I went to Canada. Like, right across the border, we had to stop for gas, and I was like, get one of these candy bars or chocolate bars.
And they were like, it's chocolate.
And I ate it.
Say chocolat.
So do you ever go to the truck stop buffet? Have you been to that place?
It is also closed now. Like,
oh God, they're closing. Canada.
I used to go in high school too, like all the time. One time I snuck out of the house because it was 24 hours. It is a truck stop that also has a hotel. I don't know why there's multiple.
24 hour buffet.
Trucks buffet. Truck stop hotel.
Kiss my ass, Las Vegas. Eat your fucking heart out.
I have to say, the buffet was only between the hours of noon to 5.
Oh, I was hoping you'd say weirdly all night for some reason.
Standards.
Yeah,
3 a.m. buffet food.
Oh, damn.
Just pizza rolls as far as the eye can see.
That should be, that's when you brought up the thing in Alabama. I mean, that should be, some enterprising person should put buffets in all these dead malls.
That's what this is. And it's packed the fuck out.
Perfect sense.
Yeah, it's packed out. But they've got pizza. They've got fucking lemon pepper wings. They've got egg rolls. They've got salad. They've got a goddamn dessert buffet with every kind of fucking pie. And the whole time I was just sitting there, having worked in restaurants for a long time, just being like, this is probably all gross.
82 pounds of mashed potatoes.
I mean, it's kind of what it was. It was like, we fucking dare the citizens of Auburn to eat a million calories in under 3 weeks.
The Mohawk Inn, I just want to say, high caliber buffet.
Oh,
high
is that
quality?
Right?
Yes.
What was the best item on that? On
I
that
would say
there?
Like the prime rib.
Oh, okay, yeah, sure. Yeah. That's always the clear winner of most buffet situations.
I when I was in high school, there were so many buffets around, and that was like the staple of my diet. That every day on summer vacation, I would go to some crappy buffet.
Yeah,
And because it was lunch, it would be $6.
Yeah, insane.
Yeah. Yeah, so you would just go there, Hong Kong Super Buffet or Ryan Steakhouse or even KFC buffet.
Uh huh. Yeah,
and it would just be
there was a Pizza Hut buffet.
Oh yeah, ooh. Pizza Hut buffet. Oh man. It was just the second, the grade B pizzas, but it's just
that ZD shit.
There was a while where I wouldn't go to a restaurant if it wasn't all you can eat.
Really?
Yeah. I was like, why? For who? For what?
What are the best ones that are just in Canada?
The best one is called, there's a few. I mean, Mohawk Inn, as I said, was great.
Yeah, but that's not a chain, is it?
No, the best chain is called The Mandarin, and it is Chinese food, and it's I almost said high quality Chinese food. I don't know how high quality it is, but they pretend it's a real fancy place. There's kois in the koi pond.
Oh,
and,
yeah, sure.
They'll have crab month where there's crab legs. And they've got sushi, but
Chinese
food.
Shots fired at Red Lobster.
Yeah, truly. It's just it's just great. It's a chain. It's amazing. Mostly Chinese food, but then they have some American food too.
Oh, okay. So they got
one weird pizza.
French fries and pizza.
They do have French fries and prime rib probably.
Oh, okay,
gotcha. Donut
steak. You can order a steak and they'll those buffets where they'll make it in front of you.
Oh yeah, whoa. Yeah, you got, yeah, yeah, with yeah. The old the Golden Corral there.
Yeah, and the Mandarin's
step it up
huge.
Old country buffet.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, there's one right by my
house.
And there
are people they cut the meat for you.
Golden Corral's they're doing what?
There's an old, what's it called? Old time. What's that place called?
There's one here. It's called something else, old
town.
In Virginia, it was old country.
It's
buffet.
Hometown.
Yeah, that's right by my house. We were gonna go
there
the other day. Is it okay?
That's up in.
We went to the Olive Garden instead. What a mistake.
So I've told this before, but we have a bunch of friends from Iowa, and they refer to that part of Burbank because it's got Walmart, Home Depot, Olive Garden, all the chain shit. They refer to that part of Burbank as Little Des Moines.
Oh yeah,
that's one.
A Michaels is
so close to my house.
Get some crafting supplies. They got the Old Navy, they got the Michaels,
Marshalls.
REI, all that shit.
Yes, and my favorite waxing and nail place.
Oh,
Polished,
right on.
If you guys are interested.
All right.
It's where I send Aussies that I have on my my tour because they all want to, go to Ulta. And I'm like,
it's
the huge makeup store. Yeah.
There's an Ulta, though, in Hollywood, too.
Oh, no shit.
Yeah, where that Target is.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Mm-hmm. No, but you just want to send them to Burbank.
I just want them really to experience.
Well, they were close to the IKEA, too, which is fun.
Just got to soak in the whole Burbank experience.
The new super IKEA.
Listen, I love Burbank.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. Burbank's cool. Nice.
Burbank has
that street where it's like 6 gun stores, 3 Halloween stores, and a bunch of used clothes.
I went into one of those gun stores because we had a weird neighbor for a minute, and Hampton was out of town. My boyfriend. He was like, you have to get
nothing
a gun.
Nothing replaces a boyfriend like a gun.
And so I went to the gun store and I was like, I just need a little gun for me. And then he gave me.
Oh, those guys love you, by the way. You made their fucking week.
Here's a pink sniper rifle. The bullets are $40 a piece. You're going to want to be about 1,000 yards before you pull the trigger.
Because the gun I suggested, they were like, no, that's not powerful enough. And so
we call this bazooka the Widowmaker.
How many times did he say
maker?
Stopping power?
I was in there for maybe 5 minutes because he put a gun in my hand and then I almost started crying and I went, I can't get this. And I left. And then a year later, I probably wouldn't have been allowed to buy a gun because I'm not a citizen.
Oh, well.
Not at a gun store.
Yeah, well, you just drive out to the Bass Pro Shop out there in Rancho Cucamonga.
There's a gun show in the alley right now.
In the basement, we're having a gun show.
Yeah, I couldn't believe,
let me
like,
show
as a
you
Canadian.
A gun.
Anyways, we got an alarm system.
A country with a mental health program in place definitely don't want you to have a gun.
Fuck no.
Now, any old whack job American.
I would definitely, the gun would somehow end up in his, or I'm just assuming it's a he who's attacking me. Like, you know what I mean? Like, that would, he'd so quickly get the gun away from me and shoot. Like, that's what would happen. I would just be, like, giving my predator a gun.
But dudes are too fragile to be like, pink gun, gay.
It wasn't pink. I would have painted
why they
it
make
pink.
Them pink.
That's why they make them pink, is because if your attacker gets the gun, he's like, I will not touch a pink gun ever. As long as you can put me in the ground, having never touched a pink gun.
I'm surprised they didn't try and sell you one of those weird sort of MacGyvered like gun purses. Where it's just like,
where it's got like a gun.
Where it's like, yeah, it looks like a purse, but it's actually
this gun looks like lipstick. I'm like, I'll shoot myself in the face. What are you doing?
How many accidental suicides do they have with this thing?
Oh, if you go to like a gun and knife show, there are like guys there that sell these like, and they have to be illegal, where it's like these modified things where it's like, it's a cell phone. Looks like a cell phone, but it's a gun. And it's just like, oh my god!
Yeah, you're playing with brushes, a gun.
But it's like a Nokia brick phone from the 80s. It's like a double barrel shotgun.
Yeah,
inside.
Everyone's gonna know that's not kosher.
It's like, oh, I just want to use my phone. It's a fucking it's a shoulder.
Check it out. Looks like a baby bottle.
It's actually a shoulder mounted rocket launcher.
My god, is that my phone? Sorry, you can just turn that alarm off. Don't know what that was for. What time is it?
I don't know. It says weekend snooze.
That's what I call this right now. I'm sorry, guys.
We're interrupting your weekend nap.
What time does it say?
6:24.
Great. That was probably because I like had a show or something, and I was like, I need a nap before the show.
I saw the speaking of that super IKEA, I saw the saddest thing when they close the actual like
they sell a
IKEA.
Gun there.
The old IKEA. Yeah, but that's like really minimalist.
Yeah, it didn't have the firing pin, couldn't use it. All the parts of my gun are here.
We were picking stuff up and it was the last day of the old IKEA before they closed it down.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And I was checking out and I went by the, you know, the little cafe thing that has like the hot dogs, the coffee.
And the meatballs.
Like, no, not the meatball, just like the bare bones one.
Right? The one by the used to be by the checkouts.
Yes.
And, get a hot dog for $1.
And there's this like little, there's this little old man just looked so sad. And he was just like, oh, so you all are closing this one? Oh. And he like apparently like would go there every day to get his coffee.
Damn it.
And just sit there. And it was, and I think I saw the gears moving in his mind.
I hate you for telling this story.
And he
he's
was
at Harry's family restaurant now.
and I don't know if he could have like walked the extra like 3/4 of a mile. Because
he didn't move
to.
Far. Yeah, you don't live here. You don't know. Right, but it's just down the street.
And he just was so heartbroken because that was his like the center of like at that. Because like when old, certain, like usually old people get their routines down. Yes. And this was like the one of the peaks of his day where he went to IKEA and got his like $1 coffee.
Yeah, yeah.
And I just want to say that
and watched like a flaneur.
Meanwhile, even young people have a routine, and when that gets fucked up, we get upset. Yeah.
Meanwhile, his other friend at the nursing home is the guy with the oxygen tank who walks to flappers and fucking heckles.
There's an oxygen tank heckler there?
Well, there was a few years ago. I hadn't seen him in a while. I couldn't imagine what happened to him.
Probably died.
I'm laughing too hard. Yeah. Boom, boom, boom.
Yeah. I explained flappers to my wife. She was just like mortified. Yeah.
I want to go out on a limb and tell you, flappers is my favorite club in the city.
Oh, it's fun. Yeah.
I like it mostly because it's so close to my house.
You sure? Yeah.
It's great. It's like getting to do an out of town gig and staying in town.
Yeah. Well, there was a guy, and I hadn't seen him in a while, but he started off as just a heckler with an oxygen tank, and then by the end,
he was a comic with an oxygen tank.
He was. He started signing up for the classes, and he would just be on stage. So he started off as just a guy that we all just assume escaped a nursing home and just like would come there every day. It would just sit in the crowd, and you would just hear like, you would hear his pump going.
I have seen this guy.
Yeah, yeah. And then he would just heckle, and then at some point, I don't know if he took the classes or if he just started figured out how to sign up. But
his
then,
heckles got better.
Yeah, and then he was just funnier than everybody on stage.
I went to a small high school. I was like kind of like a weirdo hippie kind of person. Like I was on the improv team, but I was also like the soccer goalie. And I
What was the high school improv team like?
Did you have a Rusted Root CD?
I was a Rusted Root CD.
Don't
for
know.
12
I
years.
Honestly don't know what that is.
Like a kind of hippie band from around then.
Got it. I'm probably like a lot younger than you guys.
Well, no, it's probably like some Canadian like equivalent sort of thing.
I think there is. Like, what's that band that everyone, the lead singer just
tragically
died?
Hip.
Oh, yeah, the Hip.
Gord.
Yeah. The Gord. Oh, R.I.P.
Gordy. Gordy Doug. No, fuck. I'm a shitty Canadian. I'm such a shitty kid. I've lived here for so long, too. Like, I've lived in the States for so long. And also, like, I'm a shitty Canadian because when I went to university, my major was American Studies. I just studied the United States. That was what I did.
Oh, okay. But yeah, well, the improv team.
So I was on the improv team, which is why I do comedy, by the way. Because in Canada, they have this crazy thing, and I think it's amazing. It's called the Canadian Improv Games. And schools from all across the country do this, like, these improv games, and they're like short form games, but they compete, and there's like regionals, there's like local, then there's regionals, and there's nationals. I went to improv camp through the Canadian Improv Games.
This is what I've said before about Canada. It's like, this is the society you can fucking have and you don't spend all goddamn money on defense. You can have crazy fun stuff like improv competition.
Amazing. We need to socialize UCB.
I know. We need to nationalize UCB. They are failing, so let's go ahead and do that.
It like changed my life. And there's been people like almost every Canadian comic I know was in the Canadian Improv Games, or they went to like Humber, which is a school for comedy. But a lot
what's it called?
Humber?
Like Humber for comedy.
It's like a comedy program that a lot like Will. I love to tease Weldon. Like Will Weldon, because I was like, you went to Humber for like you studied comedy in college, and so did I think Steph. That I'm not tracks. Sure if Steph Tolev did, but like Julia Lakowitz did. Oh, okay. Matt Oprah. Like I bet Deb DiGiovanni did. Yeah. I'm not sure. But the Canadian Improv Games, like Sandra Oh was part of the Canadian Improv Games. You know her?
Yeah, from Grey's Anatomy.
Yeah, Tat Maslany.
No shit.
From Tatiana Maslany, she's in Orphan Black.
Yes. Yeah.
Brent Butt.
What?
I think he did that. Brent Butt from Corner Gas.
I think he was part of... don't know. He might have been a little too old. Like, it started only like... But he's really involved in Canadian comedy. My parents fucking love him. Anyways, it's amazing.
Yeah.
So don't make fun of me.
No, I wasn't.
No, not at all.
No. I was literally just like thinking how great the society could be.
It was my life.
I was just like, because it's weird, because when people talk about arts programs in like high schools, I think that's awesome, and there should be more of it.
Yeah.
I went to a high school that didn't have that sort of thing. Like, they boarded up. We had a stage in the gym for, like, ostensibly a drama club, and they just boarded it up and turned it into the weight room.
Yeah.
Jesus. So there was just, like, the stage.
All we had was...
And it had, like, just
performative
benches
squats.
And stuff.
Yeah. Exactly. All we had was German club, and for Oktoberfest, we drank ginger ale and ate hot dogs.
Like, we had... Our school band was, like... It was
Limp Bizkit.
No, like, it might as well be. It was like eight. There was like nine dudes. Six of them played guitar.
So you had Spinal Tap. Guitars.
That's how you get a Leonard Skinner. Five guitarists showed up,
and they would play like AC/DC covers. It was our like school marching.
Our school band was
the school
like
bus
huge.
Was a Trans Am.
And yeah. everyone took music. Like you had to take music, and I don't know.
That's so nice.
Canada's like. So much better than here.
Yeah. Fuck yeah. As far as that shit goes.
The school system here blows my goddamn mind. I'm like, what do you mean you have to like strategically figure out where you're going to live so your kids can go to a school that's not garbage?
Oh, man.
Like,
yeah.
It's crazy.
I have many friends who lived outside of town but maintained trailers in like random trailer parks in town they didn't live in specifically so they could have an address to go to Auburn schools and stuff.
In Canada, I mean, I could be wrong and maybe we'll get some hate mail.
But those trailers did turn out to be fun party places in high school.
That's
so.
What you want.
That's what you really, they really sowed the seeds for something great down
the
road.
Let me get my kid a little fuck hut off to during study hall.
Kind of, yeah.
I lived in the country, so we went to a lot of parties. There was like this older dude who like had always had a huge party at his barn that we'd all go to.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
How much older?
I never saw him. It was so big that I like never saw him. But it was like in the middle of the woods and like at Halloween it was in his barn. And then in the summer it was like in his forest. And it was just like insane. There was like a DJ in a tree.
He's got his own forest.
Was he like a weird like
that's the thing.
Demigod or something.
Where I grew up was like the country, but then like money. Like people had money. I didn't necessarily.
Yeah, yeah.
But
no, I know what you mean.
It was really weird. Like everyone had a car because either there was just like a worn down car in your front lawn, or your parents were rich as fuck and bought you a car immediately.
This sounds like Alabama.
Yeah,
yeah. Very similar.
Campbellville, Ontario.
Campbellville. I love it. Sorry.
So I was on this. I was a soccer goalie.
That's
I also
right.
snowboard. Like I my snowboard would be in my car every day, and I just after school go snowboarding because I live near a hill. And I was like,
what kind
a
of
vegan.
Car was it?
Thank you for asking. It was a Nissan Pathfinder.
Hell yeah. This is different one that you ended up living in, right?
Yeah. So then later, my grandmother gave me her car, and it was a Toyota Camry. And I actually have it tattooed on me. Give you.
Oh.
Oh, hell yeah.
In. Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, it's pretty. I'm pretty fun.
Oh, that's awesome.
I feel like I'm definitely talking in an Alabama accent now.
Hey, it's okay.
Yeah, I'm pretty fun. It's because you keep doing it.
Pretty cool.
Where are you from?
Virginia.
Got it.
Well, so fish, I guess. But the other part, the part no other comedian is from. I mean,
oh,
all these
really?
Comics are like, I'm from Virginia. Oh, which part? Fairfax or Alexandria? I'm
Hampton's
like, oh, yeah,
from
DC.
Warrenton.
Yeah, like by Washington, D.C.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah.
That's where usually like your parents are like, one day you'll go do things with your life. And mom were like, don't talk too much. People might start to think things.
They like, might what? Start. They might start thinking you need a pink gun.
Listen, underachieve, and then
trade
it makes
school.
It easier to just regular achieve.
Hell's like, bells, what? Richard. I'm going to buy you a pink gun right now with your fucking name on it. You break my heart like this.
From like Chesapeake, Portsmouth, like Hampton Roads. Greg Edwards, the only other guy I know from that. Program.
Oh, okay, yeah, right.
He's
on.
A winner.
Yeah. Hell yeah.
This sounded sarcastic, but I meant it.
No, really.
Well, he's a fucking winner. that's great.
But yeah, you said you'd go snowboarding and stuff like that. Did you ever like fuck yourself up doing that?
I mean, I definitely like I did that. I like would do the half pipe and the jumps and stuff, but like I guess I wasn't amazing. I did once like hit my head and like get knocked out, but
oh, shit.
I woke up like pretty much immediately after. One of my favorite snowboarding stories, and I was just talking to my friend who visited town about it, and it doesn't even have anything to do with snowboarding, but we lived like, so Campbellville is like an hour from Niagara Falls border with the States.
Right.
Oh, okay.
Which is like when you're in high school and you have a car, you're like, an hour is nothing. This is great. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So one day we were snowboarding.
They got shitloads of buffets there.
So many buffets. So one day we were snowboarding and then with my friend Dave and my friend Mark, and Mark had to go to work, but he really wanted like McChicken from McDonald's, but like, he's like, but I want it from the States. It's so much better from the States. So he filled
grass
my-
is always greener, man.
Truly. He filled my car. It might have been like a Mc rip. Like something maybe we didn't have.
Oh, okay.
He went to work, but before he did, he like filled my car up with gas, and then me and Dave drove to the States and got McChickens or whatever, and then like drove it back to Mark's work, and he worked at a skateboarding shop. Like I just feel like it's all so on brand for like who I was at the time. Yeah,
so that's I like that. That's what there is to do. Gotta go to the States and get them preservatives.
Yeah.
Oh, we went up. By the way, on the break, we went up to Nashville, and I had maybe one of the top five meals of my life.
Was it chicken?
It was chicken. It was at a place called Monell's. And we didn't know shit about it. I was with Joe Raines, and we were looking
so much name dropping.
We were looking for a place to eat, and
Joe Raines.
This place had 5 stars on Yelp with like 2,000 reviews, and I was like, it must be pretty good. And we got there, and this is the place. It's a small house. It's got 3 tables that hold about 20 people, and you're supposed to just sit down, and then as soon as the table fills up with strangers, then they just start bringing the food out, and it's a flat rate for just like $25
to sit
down.
So you just have to wait until the table fills up?
And it fills up immediately, and then they try to murder you with food.
Wow.
And it's amazing.
I want to go there. That
it
sounds
was
great.
The shit. And they just start bringing food out.
And you don't even get to pick.
Well, they have different stuff every day. So you can go on their website and see what it's going to be.
It's like Hogwarts.
But yeah. But we were... Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's the sorting hat of cholesterol and carbs.
I love it.
And I was...
I've been eating like so fun over the holidays.
Oh, hell yeah. Me too. I got back and I gotta go to...
I'm still like just doing it. Okay.
Oh, really?
I'm like, wait till... I'm eating shitty till 2019.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've committed now to finishing the year out strong.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm also like drinking really early in the morning.
I mean, started with shower beer today.
Yeah. Yeah.
I started with a mimosa today.
Ooh.
I like left
cold
my house to get this
great.
Shit.
I had a pound and a half of ham sandwich.
Yes.
And not so just fun. Like, not like ham steaks just piled on top.
Whoa, really?
Yeah. I made a ham. So I was telling Rick this.
Yeah, most of what we talked about before the podcast.
Yeah, I made a ham that I glazed with
Welcome
root
to the
beer.
Hamcast.
Like, yeah, I made
a root beer glaze.
Ham.
These two will put soda on meat.
Fuck yeah.
Oh, yeah.
They're from the South.
And
I just put classical gravy on meat.
My wife and I made an 8-pound ham between the two of us.
Yes.
So it's just like...
It's a ham.
But the thing is that by, like, normally people are like, oh, yeah, ham's pretty dynamic. You can make, you know, soup and shit with it, you know, split pea soup. And I'm just like, no, you don't understand. I covered this thing in soda. Like, you cannot do anything but just eat the ham.
Yeah.
So, yeah, because it was weird because when I bought the ham, me and the guy at the butcher shop were sitting there like, all right, what soda should you, because we were, like, going back and forth, and we were just like, would grape soda work on a ham?
Oh.
And
it was I just bet it would.
Like, yeah.
Yeah.
And we were just going back
cream
and
soda,
forth.
Though.
Yeah. And but yeah, we've just been eating like
surge
soda.
Surge ham.
Surge ham. Yeah. Yeah, dude.
If you want to be just... LA about it, use La Croix.
Oh, La Croix ham.
Somehow this ham doesn't just taste like air now.
I know. Oh my God.
Yeah, but I just
that's our next sketch, man. Surge ham is
surge
great.
Ham.
Oh, you dude, just show the person dude. Reducing the surge and then pouring it on the ham, and then you just eat the ham, and Ace of Spades starts playing, and they just kick the fucking table over. It's like,
dude, like Mountain Dew ham
punch
would
dancing.
Actually work, though.
A Mountain Dew ham? It's
yeah.
A citrus?
But
then it would have low testosterone.
But I've just been eating soda-covered
Yellow 5
ham.
That's so
for
insane.
Like, the last few days. This thing's going
to
kill me.
What kind of root beer
you're not
going
to make it to 2019.
People are picky about their root beer.
Virgil's.
Okay.
The good stuff.
Going to
I was
going to
use
you went
Barks,
to Rocket Fizz
but,
to get
yeah,
ready for
I don't
ham.
Like Barks.
Barks is, but like.
It's got that bite.
To put on a ham, though.
I don't want my soda to bite.
No.
Yeah, put on a ham.
No, what's that red crew? Put tab ham.
Tab ham.
Oh, God.
What
I'm
about
doing
like
a
Coke?
Diet soda ham would just be the most disgusting.
Would Coke be good? Like,
Yeah, the guy that was there was just like, no, you got to do orange soda. And I was like, oh, that might work. And then.
That's some weird ass California.
He was
shit.
Pulling your leg.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, it was great. But the thing is that it's not particularly dynamic.
Yeah.
So I've just been eating soda, like just some shit that like a 10-year-old would think of. Like,
it was, but they like, wouldn't make it. Yeah, like it's an adult to use.
Yeah,
said.
Like a big situation. Like, ooh, I'm a big
Captain
person.
Crunch and Orange Crush.
Yeah, exactly.
I made a sassafras swine.
Grab yourself a can of pork soda, and you'll be feeling just fine. Ain't nothing quite like sitting around the house, swilling down them cans of swine.
Georgea, tell us about your album.
My new album is called Cash Grab. You can get it like on iTunes. You can listen to it on Spotify. You can get it on Amazon. I think cool. You can like order it or I don't know. But I have physical copies like on me. But I don't want you to find me. but like, yeah, it's available.
But when you go,
for purchase.
If you go on the road, if you go find see Georgea do stand up somewhere,
yes.
Probably will have the copies with you.
And a special thing like online, you can get it there. That's the label.
Oh yeah, sure.
So they have lots of like great albums. And
yeah,
mine is one of them.
Very
mine is
cool.
One of the greats.
Well, that's awesome. Well, yeah, and plug your social media. Where can people
yeah.
find it on the internet? And stuff
well,
like
I do want to say if you live in LA, I have a weekly show every Wednesday downtown at Ham and Eggs Tavern. You should come to that. How many of your listeners live here, you think?
We got a big chunk of LA
people. Okay, great.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, every Wednesday starting back like the 9th of January because of the holidays.
Yeah,
does
okay.
Comedy. But please come to that. And you can find me at Georgea Brooks everywhere. Like, and my name is spelled Georgea Brooks. This is, I never do this much like explanation about that. Anyways, I'm online. Also, my cat has an Instagram that you should follow too.
Okay. Yeah. What's that?
It's Jojo _ Sphinx.
J-O-J-O.
You know it.
_ Sphinx.
Yep.
Do it. So follow Georgea, follow Jojo, yeah. and check out all the stuff she's got going on. Rick, tell people where they can find you on the internet, sir.
I'm on Twitter sometimes. And
see, this is
anyone
I
on anything? No, you should do it the way you're doing it. And I'm just 35 going, what happened?
Does your MySpace still play page still exist, yeah, Rick?
I tracked that down and made sure that it's gone.
Oh, man.
Why would you shut down a platform for people to find you?
Because it's just like, I'm sad today, and this is why I blog.
I'm sad. Well, no, actually, it's 2009, and I'm mad.
I got to see
it. It was the Bush years, so it was mostly just like,
this is as bad as it'll ever get.
I used to care. I used to march around all the time.
Oh, like a woman.
And, everyone now, it's
you
like,
will listen to this. This bike is a pipe bomb song.
Yeah, it's a lot of that shit. I was in Chicago, so it was a lot of like, we fucking blew up that goddamn statue of the cop or the hay market. Everyone's a communist, but they're all like just working at Home Depot and shit. And now I'm like burnt out. I'm just like, man, I hope, fuck, I just hope he has a heart attack. That's how I feel about politics now.
That's so funny.
I just hope he has a heart attack.
He has a heart attack before I have a heart attack.
Yeah, basically. Yeah, I'm not going to have one now. I'm just trying to be so angry. But anyway, I'm not on MySpace, but that's the main point of that. It's
the last page on MySpace.
Yeah.
There is somebody,
no, there's always going to be a metal band who's
like
still
a race
there.
To the bottom to see who's going to have the last personal page.
Justin
on
Timberlake bought the thing, so he'll have the last page, I think.
Just him and Tom out drinking.
Yeah.
I'm on Twitter, though, and Rick Wood, but the O's and Wood are zeros because a psychic life coach got my handle before me. He's in Mesa, Arizona.
We should also plug the psychic life coach.
Because Rick Wood is such a good like stage, like I know it's your real name, but like it's just such a good name.
I used
but
to
then,
hate it when I played music. I was like, Rick Wood, no one wants to listen to music by Rick Wood.
But then you're like, but I found comedy. Now and it's
everybody in a prog rock like, band in the 1970s from Britain was named Rick Wood.
There's a shitload of Ricks playing prog. And you know what? I used to really that was my jam when I was a teenager. So I didn't do a lot of dating because I had to finish this 22-minute song about Middle Earth.
Yeah, dude.
Hey, man, that Yes album will get you. It's a whole side.
We have a love of Canada based solely on the band Rush.
Yeah, hell yeah, dude.
I almost got beat up by these Navy dudes from Thunder Bay, Ontario once. It was
what?
Like I was really drunk. I was there for a wedding. And somehow I got
that
drunk
wedding
with
cursed.
With some people from the wedding and my wife and her sisters. And then these Canadian dudes were hanging out. And I was like, shit-faced kind of, but you know when you could sense the shift in a conversation? We're like, oh, these dudes are mad now.
Yeah.
And then one
of
them like kind of got up and his arm was tense. I was like, I'm going to get punched in the face again. And then I just went, hey, you guys like Rush? And then the guy goes, oh, yeah, man, Tom Sawyer, YYZ. I was like, fuck yeah. And then me and this dude nerded out so hard, and then his friend got up and just walked away. And my wife says he went out to the balcony and goes,
"Oh, those guys are getting pretty heavy into the Rush titles there, and I don't know them that well. I got a little embarrassed."
Oh my God.
I was going to fuck his shit up with his own pink gun, but then we heard Rush.
I'm listening to a podcast right now, and it's about Thunder Bay being like the murder capital of Canada.
Well, they were about to do a little exporting of murder to a Hyatt in Toronto that night.
But Getty Lee
saved by moving pictures. Yeah.
God, you
Concert House!
I love that strategy, because people, you know, there's so many different strategies you can employ against the person that wants to fight you. You decided to bore them with prog rock.
That dude, one dude was really into it. I mean, I guess that's I took amazing. My gamble on a stereotype of like, "Hey, every Canadian likes Rush."
Yeah, because you could
that's all I hate. Was I going to be like, "Hey, you guys like Triumph?"
No, you could have went in the wrong direction and been like, "Yo, dude, you like Bryan Adams?"
Yep.
And they're like, "We can kick this guy's
I'll cut
ass.
You with a fucking knife."
Yeah, it'd be a stain on a hotel wall that someone had to pay too much to get removed.
You can find
I'm
us
a Tom
on
Tom Cochran guy myself.
I'll run to you wherever you go.
That's not even Bryan Adams.
Oh, is that Richard Marx? Sorry, Richard. I'm still thinking about the compilations.
The quiet
you're gonna get your
what's
stuff
the
messed up.
Oh yeah,
a lot of bad music.
Yeah, sorry, I'm gonna get stabbed. You can find us on Facebook, facebook.com/thegoodspod. We're on Twitter @thegoodspod. Every episode ever, youtube.com/thegoodspod. And big shout out to our friend Richard Eden up there in the Klondike doing the hard work at thegoodspod.com. Buy a shirt, prowrestlingtees.com/thegoodspod. Pat, what's the folks doing when they get to iTunes?
Oh, rate, reviews, and subscribe. Tell friends, shows the attitude of gratitude.
And if you don't have the attitude of gratitude, Daddy, you get a pink gun. And we'll see you next week.
The Goods from the Woods was mixed, edited, and distributed by me, Rivers Langley. You can find the show on Twitter @TheGoodsPod. Our theme song was composed by DJ Smiles. Check him out on Twitter @DJ Smiles.